The Phoenix Suns have made a huge leap this season. They're just 2 years removed from a 19-win campaign. And this year, the Suns hold the second-best record in the association and enter the playoffs as the number two seed in the Western Conference. I'm Madeline Burke for Sports Illustrated, along with Rohan Nadkarni and Ben Pickman. And when looking at the Suns' success this year, we've seen praise for Chris Paul, admiration for the development of Devin Booker. But, Ro, as you wrote in today's Daily Cover, general manager James Jones deserves some credit here. Tell me a little bit about the conversation you had with him.
Yeah, Maddie, I just thought it was really interesting getting a chance to pick James Jones's brain about, you know, what he's been trying to do with the Suns since he was elevated to the full-time general manager role about 3 years ago. Something he told me that really stuck with me, he's been trying to raise the floor of this team. Obviously, Phoenix is coming off a super long playoff drought. They've been mired in the lottery for, you know, over 10 years now. He really wanted to raise the floor of this team, and you see that with some of the veterans he brought in, even before Chris Paul got to this team. Guys like Cameron Payne, who was outcast from a couple other franchises, Dario Saric, even someone like Frank Kaminsky, who's given them valuable minutes during the regular season. It was interesting to hear his philosophy about raising the floor, making this team more competitive. And we saw that pay off in the bubble last year when they went 8-0 in Orlando during their time in the bubble. So much so that it got the attention of a guy like Chris Paul, who already had a previous relationship with Monty Williams. And it does seem like what James Jones was doing, trying to get this team back toward respectability, hiring a coach that's popular with players, was enough to attract a superstar talent like Chris Paul, who is going to get some MVP votes this year as he's helped lead the Suns to that second seed.
You know, Ro made the key point. Since January 28th, this team, this rebuilt team, has been the league's best team. They have the league's best record since that point, going 43-13. You look at it in that span, the Phoenix Suns, they are number one overall in offensive rating, number seven in defensive rating, one of just two teams with the Utah Jazz to be top seven in both of those categories. And they entered this series with the Lakers, you know, with a certainly more than a puncher's chance, well-deserving of home court advantage. DeAndre Ayton presents a tough matchup, or he's going to have his hands full, rather, guarding Anthony Davis. But the Suns have a number of wing pieces they're going to throw out LeBron James. Ro mentioned Jay Crowder. You have Bridges, among others. And you also have the guard depth of Chris Paul and Devin Booker. And there's some questions about how the Lakers are going to stop both of those guys in a seven-game series, right? We saw Steph Curry have a ton of success in the play-in game against the Lakers. They actually had to bench Dennis Schroeder down the stretch of the game, and Alex Caruso played a ton of minutes. But, you know, maybe LeBron James is going to have to spend a lot of time chasing Devin Booker or guarding Chris Paul in crunch time. That might be the Lakers' only option. You know, Phoenix, it's not a great matchup for them, and I will be honest, you know, heading into the play-in game and at halftime of the play-in game, I think the Suns were a little bit more optimistic about their Western Conference Finals chances than after the game when the Lakers won and the Lakers moved to their side of the bracket in this matchup. But still, I think Phoenix certainly is capable of beating the Lakers, and it should be a really interesting game. And no matter what, this has been a successful season for the Phoenix Suns. They're on the up and up, and they're really building towards something special in the future.
Well, and Ben, you mentioned that play-in game, right? That's the play-in game that the Lakers were down by double digits for most of the game and had to really fight themselves out of a hole. And for a Lakers team with Anthony Davis coming back from injury, LeBron James still coming back from an injury that he just re-aggravated, you know, a week ago or so, and we see the effects of that still in the way LeBron is playing, right? He's not elevating the same way that he usually does around the rim. His jump shot, he's not getting off the floor in the same way. And, you know, we saw later in the game when he hit that clutch three. Of course, he has that clutch factor still, but he doesn't look the same. And that is going to come into effect, especially if the Lakers are going to have to fight themselves out of a hole more than once. I mean, a one-game play-in game series is one thing, but a seven-game series where you're going that hard every night against a team who didn't just luck into the second-best record in the league. They are playing very well. And, you know, as Rohan mentioned, Chris Paul is going to get some MVP votes. And a lot of credit, too, to reuniting Chris Paul with Monty Williams, the coach that he admired so much that he had when he was first in the league in New Orleans. I think there's a lot of chemistry, a lot of respect there with player and coach, and I think that's going to translate very well in the postseason.